Prior to beginning the activity, please be sure to review the faculty information and disclosure statements, as well as the learning objectives. After listening to the activity, complete the post-test by clicking the Earn Credit link in the episode description. Downloadable slides and resources are also available. The following presentation is copyrighted by Medscape. No use, broadcast, or recording of this presentation, or any part thereof, is permitted without the written authorization of Medscape. The following presentation is part of a certified educational activity provided by Medscape Education and supported by an educational grant from AstraZeneca.
Good day. My name is Matthew Weir. I'm a professor of medicine and chief of nephrology at the University of Maryland School of Medicine in Baltimore. Welcome to this program today, which is entitled, What is Your Preference in How to Manage Hyperkalemia in Your Patients? Is it diet? Is it diuretics? Is it potassium binders? Or is it all three? And is there a strategy that you prefer or employ in these types of patients? Joining me today are two good friends and experts in this area of clinical understanding. First is Dr. Javed Butler, who is a specialist in heart failure. He's also chairman of medicine at the University of Mississippi School of Medicine in Jackson, Mississippi. And Dr. Bob Toto, who's a professor of medicine and head of the clinical program in nephrology at UT Southwestern Medical Center in Dallas, Texas. Both of these clinicians are really excellent and knowledgeable in this area about how to manage potassium homeostasis, especially in people with cardiorenal disease. Welcome, gentlemen. It's a pleasure to have you on board today.
Glad to be here.
So the goals of our conversation today are to provide some considerations with regard to what one might best describe as optimal practices in dealing with hyperkalemia, the challenge of dietary manipulation, whether or not it works, the role of diuretics, the role of potassium binders, how best to adjust your renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system blocking drugs, and even other drugs in people who have kidney disease and heart disease. And ultimately, how one can work together as a good team in educating patients about strategies for controlling electrolytes as we manipulate so many of their important medications in order to optimize medical outcomes. So this will be our overall consideration for today. To put our conversation into perspective, what I'd like to do is to start out with a case of a young guy who's only 48 years old, who has a number of medical problems which predispose him to cardiorenal disease. And they include hypertension, type 2 diabetes, and coronary artery disease. He's already had an MI. He's got a reduced ejection fraction of only 25%. His GFR is approximately 52 ml per minute. His blood pressure has been controlled with calcium blockers and beta blockers. When he was initiated on what I consider to be evidence-based and appropriate medical therapy, meaning an angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitor, his potassium jumped from 4.6 to 5.5. In response to this, his healthcare provider stopped his ACE inhibitor, stabilized the patient, adjusted his diuretics. And the real question is, where do you move from there? So just to recapitulate, he's on carvedilol, 25 milligrams twice daily, torsemide, 30 milligrams daily, hydralazine, 100 milligrams three times a day, and isosorbide, mononitrate, 60 milligrams daily. And his blood pressure is hanging in the 140s. His potassiums are hanging in the 5 to 5.5 range. The patient has been educated about a low potassium diet. So where do we go from here? Dr. Butler, why don't we start with you first? I mean, you are a heart failure specialist. This gentleman has an EF of 25%. I do see he is on a beta blocker. Is it good enough to give him nitrates and hydralazine at this particular juncture?
Yeah, so I mean, this discussion can really go in very many ways, and I'm really glad the case that you chose to discuss, because there's really nothing esoteric about this case. Like, this is a person we see in the clinic all the time. So this is a really common scenario that we deal with. To specifically answer your question, you know, hydralazine nitrates have been shown to reduce mortality in African-American patients with heart failure reduced ejection fraction who have persistent advanced heart failure symptoms on standard of care. So that is the class one indication. So it's not across the symptom class. It's not class 2 to 4. It's only class 3-4 on standard of care. So this person is not on standard of care to begin with. So the question is, do we just leave him alone? Now, if somebody is absolutely intolerant of RAS inhibitors, then using hydralazine nitrates actually makes a lot of sense. The question is, in this era, whether or not we should just give up on this person because he had one episode of hyperkalemia or not. So I think it's a reasonable option, but there are certain things missing in his care. We talked about ACE inhibitor, but the issue is, first of all, whether it's ACE inhibitor or ARNI, that's a separate debate. But mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist is missing, and that has survival benefit in this patient population. We can talk about that. But then hyperkalemia comes right back in. And then there are some new trials that have recently come out. So this discussion can go in many different directions.
So what would you do first? And do you really, I mean, has dietary restriction of potassium really helped you in your clinical practice?
Well, so this is a really difficult question, right? So dietary restrictions is obviously something we tell all our patients. I don't know how much we are equipped to give that recommendation, because remember, we can only give the recommendation based on what kind of foods we eat. There is significant differences in sort of the racial and ethnic preferences for foods and what are the potassium concentrations and all that kind of stuff. So probably you need a nutrition consult to be able to really do it. Now, it is one thing that patients who are normokalemic, who you give some dietary recommendations, and they follow and life sort of goes on. It's a completely different question if you are actually depending on the patient to maintain such dietary discretion and control that you're going to actually up titrate RAS inhibitor therapy. That makes me very uncomfortable, because if you do that and if the patient has a lapse, then you put the patient in harm's way. So the short answer is, yes, we all give dietary recommendations. They are not easy to follow, but we should still try to do that. And once you do that, if somebody is normokalemic, that's fine. But I am very uncomfortable optimizing therapy in a person with hyperkalemia, trusting that the patient will be able to maintain very tight dietary regulation forever.
So let me ask you also, before I turn to Dr. Toto, this is a bit of a quandary here, because this gentleman is already on 30 milligrams of torsemide, which is a healthy dose. He still has a potassium in the low fives, and he's not on what I would describe as any neurohormonal modulating therapy other than the beta blocker right now. I mean, are you comfortable ramping up on his torsemide in a way to create potassium raising space for the ACE or the MRA?
I'm very uncomfortable just going up on the diuretic therapy, because one issue is the renal function in this person. Two, diuretic therapy in patients with heart failure leads to actually neurohormonal activation. And then three, with all the issues related to blood pressure and hypovolemia and whatnot, I think what we need to do is to try to figure out any which way that we can get his potassium control and at least put him on low doses of RAS inhibitors and MRA. Now, in the past, the clinician that stopped the ACE inhibitor in this person is exactly what the guidelines recommended, because we did not really have any other benefit. The problem was that we were trading a long-term risk for a short-term risk, right? So yes, acute hyperkalemic risk you have subverted, but then you're taking the long-term risk of worsening cardiovascular outcomes, which is absolutely just not ideal in this particular situation.
Well, thank you. Boy, this is a tough one. Dr. Toto, my friend, you know, as I look at the meds this guy's on, his blood pressure is still in the 140s. And I, you know, my gut is, as a nephrologist, and you're a nephrologist too, is that we probably can do more from a volume standpoint here. And, you know, how would you start to adjust and substitute and alter this gentleman's medications in order to, again, facilitate not only better blood pressure control, but also maybe better strategy to attenuate his neurohormonal systems that we know are certainly going to worsen his cardiorenal failure?
Yes, no, thank you, Matt. And when I look at this, Matt, I think, well, you know, this guy's already on a pretty good dose of torsemide, as you said. I don't think if, you know, I would have to ask the question, well, do I think he's volume euvolemic now? Because if the patient with heart failure in the setting of kidney failure, and this we know that he has HFrEF, is euvolemic, you know, then I don't, you know, and that's obviously a bedside or a clinical decision. I'm not sure that pushing the diuretic is really the right way to go to create the space that you pointed out for, you know, allowing the addition of a RAS blockade. On the other hand, if he's still considered to be volume overloaded, well, maybe I do want to push the torsemide up more. But again, that's a theoretical that I'm, you know, a hypothetical I'm introducing here. But it is a variable that one has to take into consideration when you're thinking about, well, what's my next strategy. So I'm going to say
a thiazide, Bob. Would you consider adding a low dose of a thiazide to him?
Well, you could, but you know, you're going to get some more diuresis with the thiazide. And again, if the patient is you know, already, quote, you know, dried out, I mean, I don't know how well he's diuresed with this dose of torsemide. If I add a thiazide, I'm going to get some more potassium loss in the urine, lower his serum potassium, but I'm also going to potentially make him volume depleted, drive his creatinine up. And then I've got that concern, and, you know, and of course his EGFR is going to go down, and then we're going to be wondering now, do we have him over diuresed? So I'm going to say, just for the sake of discussion and argument here, that the patient is euvolemic, and that I want to approach the potassium lowering with another strategy. And I certainly agree with starting with diet training for education for the patient. And I would also be very vigorous about looking for other medications that he might be taking that could be driving his potassium up. Because although we talk, it's important to restrict the dietary potassium under these circumstances. If he's taking NSAIDs or he's ingesting potassium in his diet in unusual ways, some patients that, you know, go to herbals, they drink things that are high in potassium. I would approach this guy with, let's give him the education to lower the potassium in his diet, get his potassium down by giving him a potassium binder for a few days, repeat the potassium, he gets the dietary education, and then we see where his K is at. I don't want his blood pressure to stay up any longer than I have to. So if I can get his potassium down below 5, hopefully in the 4 to 4.5 range, then I want to start him on, I would start with an ACE inhibitor or an angiotensin receptor blocker, and then, you know, add in a mineralocorticoid antagonist because of his HFrEF. And then I would, you know, hopefully with a dietary potassium control, see whether or not he's going to continue to need potassium binder therapy or not. But that would be my first approach.
Yeah, the real issue I think we have here is some knowledge base that adding MR blockade certainly can be a problem for the potassium. And certainly most studies with MR blockade, it can go up by 0.5 or 0.6 with ACEs or ARBs, it can go up 0.4 to 0.5. So you're almost guaranteed to have a bump in the potassium, which is probably going to push you into the high 5s and even closer to 6. No doubt about it. If we started a potassium binder, what's pretty consistent in most of the studies that I've seen is that people typically drop into the 4.5 to 4.6 range. And most often it actually occurs even with starting doses. So you don't really even need to use a higher dose. And in a sense, maybe that would be what you're suggesting, maybe a safer consideration, as opposed to, intensifying the diuretic support. It would certainly allow you the opportunity, as Dr. Butler suggested, of maybe starting to initiate low-dose ACE or ARB or low-dose MR, and then start to adjust it accordingly. Is that what you would consider, Dr. Toto? Then I'll ask Dr. Butler the same thing.
Yes, absolutely. And, I would add that it's not only studies you've seen, Matt, but these studies that you've done, you're one of the first to demonstrate the efficacy of some of the newer potassium binding agents, specifically patiromer, for lowering the serum potassium in patients like the one we're discussing today. And yeah, I think that a safe approach would be to use either patiromer or zirconium cyclosilicate. Those are both good choices, and you could treat them for a few days to get the potassium down. As you said, these agents can generally get the potassium down in the 4.5 range, even in people whose potassium is above 6. And his right now is only 5.3. I say only because it's pretty close to the upper limit of normal, at least in our laboratory. And so that's what I would do. I would try to get his potassium down now with a binder, and I'd prefer to use one of the newer binders as opposed to sodium polystyrene sulfonate, which has been around since the 50s, as you all know. And then see whether I need to continue that.
Dr. Butler, you've been treating people with heart failure for many, many years. We obviously want to enable appropriate therapy in this gentleman. Would you agree this guy's probably going to need lifelong potassium control in order to facilitate more appropriate medications? And the other question I would ask you as part of that is, as you control his blood pressure better, would you start to taper off the hydralazine and nitrates in a sense to provide him more space for the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system blockade?
Yeah, so I completely agree with all the comments that have been made thus far. So we can have a separate debate some other day as to what should be an ideal potassium level and what all the things that we are learning in the epidemiologic studies, that mid-4 is good, and actually even with 5, there is some signal of increased mortality, and whether it is causality or confounded and whatnot. So that's a whole separate discussion for some other time. But what I do want to emphasize, however, is that if you look at the guidelines in general, they would say, 5 to 5.5, watch, 5.5 to 5.9, cut the dose in half for RAS inhibitor, 6+, hold it, and then see. Well, there are a couple of issues here. So one issue here is that the phenotype of patients that develop hyperkalemia, for the most part, does not change. So every now and then, if there is some accidental increased potassium ingestion because you were supposed to take 2 pills and you took 4 or something like that, those rare occasions aside, by and large, people who develop hyperkalemia are, your older people with heart failure, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, and that phenotype doesn't change. So even if you do something by stopping all the drugs for the short term and the potassium comes down, when you reintroduce the drugs, that hyperkalemia is going to come back in most of the patients. And we have actually seen that with these novel potassium binders, that even up to a year, you give these binders in studies, up to a year, potassium is sort of rock solid in the mid-4s. And after a year, you stop the potassium binder and hyperkalemia comes back. So your question about lifelong treatment likely needed, that is absolutely true. The second point that I will make is that, at this point, and this is getting a little bit ahead of the where the guidelines are, because the science of all of this is moving so fast that we have more and more data coming out. So at least conceptually, what I would say is that there are 5 pathways that we know for a fact improve outcomes, mortality in a person like this: modulating angiotensin 2, aldosterone, norepinephrine, SGLT2, and neprilysin, with 4 drugs. angiotensin receptor neprilysin inhibitor, MRA, evidence-based beta blocker, and an SGLT2 inhibitor. And that's the ideal therapy. So I would say anything that compromises these therapies, we have to change. So in this particular case, one thing which is compromising that is hyperkalemia. So I completely agree with all the comments made about the potassium binders. Now, as you start giving these therapy, if this person were to become orthostatic hypotensive or have low blood pressure and whatnot, absolutely, I would cut back on the dose of hydralazine nitrates.
Good. Let me ask Dr. Toto in that regard. You know, what's interesting too, and I know you see this all the time, Dr. Butler, is that there are also changes in creatinine that occur with the use of either ACE or ARB, which are often concerning for clinicians, especially if it's more than 20%. And needless to say, in somebody with HFrEF, it becomes an even more concerning issue because, again, that bump in creatinine could be a surrogate measure for activation of neurohormonal systems due to a little bit of pre-renal azotemia. You know, Dr. Toto, in your experience, are the MRA a little bit less likely to provoke changes in serum creatinine relative to ACE or ARB? Is that ever a consideration that you focus on as you adjust these medications, especially in the setting of a hyperkalemia?
That's a great question, Matt. You know, my experience is that, you know, that patients who are put on mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists like this one will have a small bump in their creatinine. And sometimes it's, you know, up to 20%. So I'm glad you brought that up, because as you were discussing that, I was thinking in my mind, well, you know, ACE inhibitors will bump the creatinine, so will ARBs, but the mineralocorticoid antagonists can do that as well. And we don't fully understand the mechanism there. It doesn't seem to be because of their, you know, diuretic, a powerful diuretic effect. It seems to be that there's some alteration and this has not been proven whether this is true or not, but whether there's some change in the glomerular filtering membrane that is a result of mineralocorticoid receptor blockade. But either way, regardless of mechanism, rather, they, you know, you can see an increase in spironolactone. Now, having said that, that wouldn't deter me from, you know, starting the patient on an ACE inhibitor or a mineralocorticoid antagonist. In this case, as I said earlier, I would start with an ACE inhibitor and then try to bring on the mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist after that, you know, because we're talking about a patient who's still got, you know, persistent hyperkalemia despite the, you know, healthy dose of torsemide, as you pointed out. So I think that's, you know, important. Now, I would also add that spironolactone can cause hyperkalemia, just like we can see with an ACE inhibitor and angiotensin receptor blocker. So not only would the creatinine be a consideration, but, you know, the potassium would too. And we've been talking about that throughout this case in terms of using, you know, RAS blockade, because RAS blockade includes ACEs, ARBs, ARNIs and the mineralocorticoid antagonists. So I want to come back to just briefly, if I could, Matt, about what Dr. Butler said. I agree with him about an SGLT2 inhibitor. I think this patient would be a great candidate for an SGLT2 inhibitor. Those drugs do not cause hyperkalemia. Now, they've been tested, at least in the renal population, I know for sure, on the background of ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers to at least for most of the studies that have been done.
So one other consideration too in these very complex patients is the fact that many people are involved in their clinical care. I mean, you may have a primary care physician, a nephrologist, a cardiologist, an endocrinologist, a nurse practitioner, a dietitian. I mean, let's agree. I mean, often these people go to multiple healthcare providers. Dr. Butler, how do you deal with that typically in your heart failure patients that you manage with your team?
Yeah, so I mean, you know, there will be hardly ever a patient that we will see that will be getting their entire care only from the heart failure clinic, right? So they have primary care physicians, then obviously patients need education for their, I mean, these are complex patients. We're not talking about low potassium diet. I mean, technically speaking, you're asking them to be on a low salt diet for their heart failure and low potassium diet if they have hyperkalemia. If they're very advanced CKD, that might have some diet considerations there. If they are overweight or have coronary disease. So, I mean, so nutritionist, dietitian involvement becomes very important, primary care. And then the patient phenotype that develops hyperkalemia usually are multimorbid. So nephrologists or endocrinologists, diabetologists. So it becomes pretty important. So communication is really education for the patient and communication between the entire team.
Excellent. Dr. Toto, how about your group?
Yeah, so... That's a great point, and it's really important that we discuss the fact that there's a team approach involved here. As Java just said, you know, the patients, the kidney disease patients, as well as the heart failure patients, are seeing multiple providers. Many of our patients with chronic kidney disease have diabetes, they're overweight or obese, and are being followed by endocrinologists. And we have a team there in our endocrinology section that is dedicated to obesity management. So we can get help from the nutritionists there, and we do. We involve them in our diabetic patients who are obese to assist with education about managing their diet as well, and specifically their potassium and sodium intake in their diet. We also, you know, part of our team includes the nurse as well as the nephrologist in our clinic who are, the nurses play an important role in helping communicate with the patients and manage the hyperkalemia. We also have nurse practitioners, physician assistants who assist us, and they do an excellent job in patient education and have more time in some instances to communicate directly with the patient in more detail about the diet, because it is complex. And so the team is a multidisciplinary effort. It's a nurse, it's a dietitian, it's the subspecialist, as well as the primary care doctor. And as Java said, it's a challenge because many of our patients also go to multiple health systems. So we can't directly communicate easily with providers who are not part of our system.
I think we're learning. I think the matter still will be how best to control that potassium in your individual patients so we can use the appropriate therapy. So I'd like to thank you, Dr. Butler, and you, Dr. Toto, for joining me in this conversation and discussion today. I'd like to thank all of you listening in for participating in this activity. And I would encourage you to please continue on to answer the questions that follow and complete the evaluation. Have a great day.